Control rooms of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant look like something from another world. Especially their iconic mnemonic panels you have surely seen in documentaries and photos. But what do they actually show? What do all these lines, symbols and glowing boxes mean? In this episode of our series, we'll explain for the first time ever what they really told the operators. And essentially, you'll see how the RBMK reactor actually works. And in a couple of weeks, we'll show you step by step how to build an accurate functional replica of one of these panels. Because not only they look incredibly complex, but they are also simply beautiful, so that's pretty much something you might want to hang on your wall. So don't forget to subscribe so you won't miss it. In the past, we already explored the overall design of the RBMK reactor, but since that was a while ago, let's quickly revisit the essentials. The reactor consists of large structural elements called schemes. Inside is active zone, that's a large cylinder made of graphite blocks. There, each vertical column contains a sealed channel, and most of them hold fuel rods. Through these channels, water is constantly pumped by main circulation pumps. There it turns into steam water mixture, which then enters drum separators. There, the steam is separated from the water and sent to the turbines, which spin the electric generators. The excess water, along with turbine condensate, returns for another round. But in reality, things are far more complex. There are countless physical and chemical processes at each stage of this cycle, and there are dozens of systems that manage that. So, what we see in the control room is a visual and logical representation of how all that machinery interacts. So, there are three operator workstations, and each is managing a different part of the reactor cycle. The first one controls the nuclear processes in the reactor core. And so, here you can see these large mnemonic displays that show the reactor active zone and control rod positions. Well, previously we covered this in detail in our episode about Scala control computer, so check it out if you haven't already. The second station handles the reactor's unit supporting systems, that's pumps, hydraulic and gas contours. They are quite complex and they are displayed on the seven large panels you see here. The third station has these two massive displays representing turbines and their auxiliary systems. And there are also two smaller panels, which represent the generators. As a little side note, the way how you can see them now is just a static test of indication, because at the working unit, all this will constantly change, blink and glow. But still, even in this condition, we can look closer, and let's start with this display. It monitors the integrity of the reactor structure. First, here are temperature alarms from countless sensors placed in critical materials, such as graphite, concrete and structural panels. The same comes for reactor schemes, S, OR, KG, E and G. But these are just alarms, so logically you may ask, and how do we get a detailed reading? So notice this, everywhere on these displays there are such notations that mark IDs of equipment. But in reality, some of them are actually Scala computer codes. So you enter them on the request keyboard in the control panel, and then Scala will return the values and the set points on these displays, or on a teletype. What is inside this circle shows the reactor's channel integrity monitoring system, and I have to say it works in a rather interesting way. So, inside the reactor's fuel channels flows highly radioactive water, so logically they must remain sealed at any time. During operation, these channels become very hot, so surrounding graphite blocks get hot too, which is not really good for their integrity. To keep this graphite cool, through gaps between the blocks is pumped a constant stream of dry nitrogen and helium. And here comes a trick. If you imagine that some channel begins to leak, this dry gas picks up moisture. And inside the reactor there are over 2000 detectors constantly monitoring that. Well, have 2000 indicators is a little bit overkill, so they are grouped in 26 zones, you can see right here. If the leak is found, the operator increases gas flow to dry this area out. And the stages of this pumping and intensity of it will be indicated by changes in triangles on this display. Now, below that, we can see a few more important systems. Let's start with this. So this rectangular shape represents the side biological shield, its so-called scheme L. Basically, it's such a tall, ring-shaped water tank, and the water inside comes using this system, from this tank to pumps and then to valves. Actually, this little chain of equipment has status elements you can find all around other displays across the control room. The logic here is really simple. It glows, it is active. It is dark, it is not active. For example, this line about the tank ID means the level inside is not as it should be. If the pump is wired, its outline lights up. If it is in a hot reserve, the inside circle will slightly glow. And as you probably already guessed, if it is running, it will glow bright. As a little side note, if there are a few pumps like here, they will never work together, because one of few will be always ready for backup. Then, this hourglass pictogram is a closed valve, and when it is open, it glows. So as you see, very simple and very logical. Okay, and now let's move on to a more complex system. So this is the cooling of control rod channels, which are marked with this notation. Technically, it is a closed loop of purified water that starts from this tank and is pumped by these pumps. But because this water passes through the reactor core, radiation can split some amount of it into hydrogen and oxygen, which is not really safe. So after pumps, it goes through these devices that strip out those gases. Then it goes through the receiver tank and inside the control rod channels to absorb heat. It becomes hot after it, so then it is cooled in heat exchangers before returning to the tank. These exchangers are cooled indirectly by technical water. A technical water comes from the cooling pond, pumped by these three large pumps. They are actually located in a separate building of the pumping station. Because this water never mixes with coolant after treatment and can return back to the pond. But there are loops with much more radioactive water inside. And I guess you can imagine what will happen if some pipe in some exchanger will break down. Basically, all that will just go to the cooling pond, polluting everything. So to avoid the chance of that, there is a so-called intermediate loop, a part of which is pictured here. It uses its own pumps to carry its water to cool those contaminated circuits. And only then this secondary water cooled using the water from cooling pond in extra exchanger of the intermediate loop. So it is much safer. And now let's move to something more interesting. So let's look at this large display. You already probably noticed it's mirrored, because left and right looks the same. That's because it shows the two sides of the unit, which are symmetrical. Here, these upper panels show warnings for pressure, temperature, and water levels for the two drum separators. If pressure gets too high, here we will see how a protection system triggers high-performance relief valves. So, as you remember, inside the drum separators comes the hot mixture of the steam and water from the reactor. And you can literally see that in simplified way on this display as well. Steam is separated from water and then goes this way, to the turbines. Well, what happens in turbine, we'll explore just a bit later. But to be short for now, from there it returns in a liquid form. It is so-called feedwater, and it is injected back into drum separators using these four lines. Three of them are for normal operation and one is a bypass for maintenance or reactor startup. From the bottom of drum separator, water goes down to four main circulation pumps. These pumps push it into main delivery collector and then back to the reactor. Well, here you may recall from our previous episodes how massive these pumps are, and to operate properly they rely on several support systems, which you can see on this display. Look closely, do you see it? The shape actually resembles the pump, which exactly that is indicated by these digits. So there are many sensors that monitor each part of the pump to catch any problems early, and well, there are points to monitor. For example, this is the lubrication system. It has a smaller pump to deliver filtered oil to the pump's bearings. As they rotate at really crazy speed, the oil gets hot, so it is cooled by technical water in special exchanger. And the same goes for the oil for the electric motor. But the bottom bearing deals with so much load that it uses a hydrostatic design. The shaft literally floats on a film of water, so basically there is no metal-on-metal contact. The water is supplied with a special line, and if there is some problem with that, protection system will immediately shut down the pump. But there is another challenge. Any leak between rotating and static parts of the pump will be obviously radioactive, because it pumps radioactive water. And to prevent that, there is another system, which injects water into tiny shaft gaps to seal them with pressure, like a liquid gasket. The supply systems for these two waters are pictured in these two bottom panels, and they are one of those cooled exactly by the intermediate loop we talked just a few minutes before. Finally, there are these displays, which represent very important part connected between pumps and drum separators. This is so-called blowdown and cooldown system, and it has two important functions. This part of the system purifies the reactor coolant. Why it has to be done? Because when it moves through the kilometers of piping all the time, it all the time will pick up chemical contaminants, which is not good for the efficiency of steam and for the integrity of systems. So here it is collected and passed through a regenerator and then an aftercooler, so that gradually reducing its temperature. Then almost cold it goes through a purification unit and then returns to drum separators. But you do not pour cold water into the hot reservoir, right? So before that, once more it passes through the regenerator to be reheated. And eventually hot water meets hot water. In emergencies or maintenance, this system also drains excess coolant inside the special tanks using these high-power pumps. During the cooldown, the same pumps are used to increase the speed of the blowdown, and that basically reduces the temperature inside the drum separators. This next large display mostly covers the return way from turbine to drum separators, so if you don't mind, we'll skip it for now and come back later. And instead, let's look at the turbine panel. There are two turbines per unit, so there are two of these displays, which are different only in IDs of the equipment. Well, I know it looks overwhelming, but it is actually very logical. So, to use the steam with maximum efficiency, the real turbine has five sections, or so-called cylinders. There is one central high pressure and four low pressure, and exactly that you can see right here. So, high-pressure steam from the drum separators enters at this place. Then it passes through stop and control valves before reaching the high-pressure section. When its job is done there, the steam enters four intermediate steam separators and reheaters. There it gets superheated and any residual moisture is removed. Then it comes to four low-pressure cylinders. So basically, the steam rotates turbine in all five cylinders, and this way its energy is used with higher efficiency. But by the time it exits them, it's already cooler and has lost energy. Now we need to return it back to reactor, but first we have to turn it back into liquid water, and here come these four condensers. You can think of them as tanks with isolated cold water pipes inside, and there the steam condenses into the liquid form. What comes out is now called condensate water. Three condensate pumps move it forward, but still this water is not perfect. It contains gases like oxygen and nitrogen, because again, radiation can split some molecules of water. Plus, there are some noble gases which come from the reactor along with steam. And this is where come these devices called three-stage ejectors. They create a vacuum with steam jets and pull out those gases from the condensate water. And after ejectors, the condensate water is purified and goes through another set of pumps. And still it is not ready, because cold water cannot be injected right into the hot reactor. So first it passes through this chain of five regenerative heaters. They are heated by steam extracted from turbine cylinders. And now the water is hot enough to be reused, but we'll get back to how it happens in just a moment, because there are a few more displays here. The bottom row here shows the lubrication system for the turbine. With the rotor 30 meters long and hundreds of tons heavy, proper oil flow and cooling is quite essential. And so these displays show various bearings, oil pumps, coolers and emergency drain systems. And finally, on the right, there are these small displays that show generator and power grid connections. There is one generator per turbine, so two generators per one reactor unit. You can see here the main transformer, grid connection lines, and also these two transformers that power the internal systems of the reactor unit. Okay, and now let's take a look at this display we previously skipped. So this is where comes the turbine condensate. But there is a little problem with it. On its long way, it picks up gases like air through microscopic gaps and bolted connections of pipes and valves. There also may appear some CO2. These gases are corrosive and must be removed, and it happens in these devices called deaerators. Inside the deaerator is injected low-pressure steam. It comes either from a turbine exhaust or, during startup, from its intake. The steam mixes with condensate and heats it nearly to the boiling. That process drives out dissolved gases, which are then vented away. And the result is clean feedwater, exactly what we need. The feedwater collects in the deaerator tank and then, using these 5 feedwater pumps, is returning to drum separators. And the big cycle starts again. What are the other displays here? Well, some part of clean condensate water can be reused to refuel various systems of power plant. Remember the first display we looked at? So there are these two arrows. That's exactly where refuel water enters the side shield and the control rod cooling systems. So this panel shows the pumping system that handles exactly that. The next two displays are related to startup and cooldown of the reactor. So during those stages, the drum separator may have too much steam inside, so it has to be removed. And so it's sent through pressure reduction valves to two auxiliary condensers cooled by technical water. The resulting condensate then sent to turbine condensers to be cleaned and returned for the main loop. The gases from these auxiliary condensers are pumped through special filters that remove any radioactive materials. And then they can be safely vented through the famous ventilation stack. Well, there are numerous other controls and indicators, and we looked just at the part of them. But I guess even this gives a very good perspective what it means to control all that. Of course, what you see at the Chernobyl control room is rather a historical look. Because the power plant, despite it was modernized after the disaster, was actually scheduled to be shut down in a perspective. So there appeared now removed computer displays, but these original controls were almost not changed. So that's it for now. Don't forget to subscribe to see our new episodes. And as always, for those who want much more, check out our Patreon page, where you can find exclusive insights, translations and technical readings. And we will see you in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.